My brothers and sisters, it's a thrill and a pleasure to be back with you. I want you to know we're two-thirds through, and I've endured two-thirds toward the end. And with your faith and prayers, we'll pursue and endure faithfully right down through to this evening. Our topic today, this morning, is on Christ, our great Creator and Redeemer. And let's look at it both from the standpoint of His earthly ministry and His pre-earth ministry and His post-earth ministry. President Benson on one occasion spoke of Christ, and he made this comment. He says, "What manner of man was Jesus during his 30 years when he was personally preparing himself for his three-year public ministry?" He came here in a state of forgetfulness with the rest of us, but he absorbed knowledge like a sponge, and he was born above the power of the fall. That made quite a bit of difference with him. President Benson goes on to say, turning to the book of Luke in the New Testament, we read these words: "Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man." Modern-day revelation, we learn that Jesus received not of the fullness at first, but continued from grace to grace. Not from sin to grace, but from grace to grace. And that's a clarification President Benson throws in there. Until he received a fullness, we too should be moving from grace to grace in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. Now, the scriptural picture of Christ is that of a cosmic picture. I mean, you just have to get way out in space, and you have to think big, real big, in order to come up and begin to grasp what the Lord has revealed concerning Christ, who is our Lord and our God, and who is our Savior and Redeemer and the great Creator of all things. I've always liked the statement in section 76 of the Doctrine and Covenants, where the Lord promises, if we're faithful, to open some of these things to our view. He says here, beginning with verse 5, "For thus saith the Lord, I, the Lord, am merciful and gracious unto those who fear me, and delight to honor those who serve me in righteousness and in truth unto the end. Great shall be their reward, and eternal shall be their glory. And to them will I reveal all mysteries, yea, all the hidden mysteries of my kingdom. From days of old and for ages to come will I make known unto them the good pleasure of my will concerning all things pertaining to my kingdom. Yea, even the wonders of eternity shall they know, and things to come will I show them, and even the things of many generations. And their wisdom shall be great, and their understanding reach to heaven. And before them the wisdom of the wise shall perish, and the understanding of the prudent shall come to naught. For by my Spirit will I enlighten them, and by my power will I make known unto them the secrets of my will, yea, even those things which eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor yet entered into the heart of man." On one occasion, the prophet Joseph Smith put the whole of section 76 into poetic verse. This was triggered by a poem which W.W. Phelps wrote, dedicating it to the prophet, entitled, "Come With Me." I'll just read the first verse of Brother Phelps' poem to give you the flavor of things. "Go with me, will you go to the saints that have died, to the next better world where the righteous reside, where the angels and spirits in harmony be, in the joys of a vast paradise. Go with me." And then the prophet responded to that invitation and got the incentive by Brother Phelps, and he took Section 76 and he put it all into poetry form. Now, you need to keep in mind that when the prophet Joseph Smith wrote Section 76 to begin with, he only wrote 1/100th part of it. He says, for example, here in the teachings, page 305, "I could explain 100-fold more than I ever have of the glories of the kingdoms manifested to me in the vision, were I permitted, and were the people prepared to receive them." The interesting thing about that statement in relation to this poetic verse is that at times he got into a little tight place in getting things to rhyme. And so he pulls in some of this other stuff. And this poetic verse then becomes an elaboration by inspiration, an inspired elaboration in poetic form of that great revelation called the vision. Now let me read, for example, these same words in the poetic vision of the prophet that I've read to you. "For thus saith the Lord, in the spirit of truth I am merciful, gracious, and good unto those that fear me and live for the life that's to come. My delight is to honor the saints with repose that serve me in righteousness, truth to the end. Eternal's their glory and great their reward. I'll surely reveal all my mysteries to them, the great hidden mysteries in my kingdom stored. From the council in Kolob," and that's the great council of the gods, and we'll have something to say about that. "From the council in Kolob to time on the earth, and for ages to come, and to them will I show my pleasure and will, what my kingdom will do. Eternity's wonders they'll truly shall know. Great things of the future I'll show unto them, the things of the vast generations to rise. Their wisdom and glory shall be very great, and their pure understanding extend to the skies. And before them the wisdom of wise men shall cease, and the nice understanding of prudent ones fail. For the light of my spirit shall light mine elect, and the truth is so mighty, 'twill ever prevail. And the secrets and plans of my will I will reveal, the sanctified pleasures which earth when earth is renewed. What the eye hath not seen, nor the ear hath not heard, nor the heart of the natural man ever hath viewed." Now that's the poetic vision of that little statement that I just read. Now when we speak of the order of the cosmos, we need to understand that space and time and stars and planets pertain to man on this earth, and all of these are centered in a mighty orb which we call Kolob, as the prophet said, "From the council in Kolob till time on the earth." And let me here just to bring in some information from the Kolobic Kleis, explain what I mean on this. Let's turn to the little unit in the book of Abraham called facsimile number 2. In facsimile number 2, as the prophet translates some of these items, he makes certain clarifications in figure 1. He says it signifies Kolob. Kolob signifying the first creation, nearest to the celestial or the residence of God. Now note, he doesn't say this is where our Father in heaven lives. It's nearest to the celestial or residence of God. First in government, the last pertaining to the measurement of time. And this is the first and the last business again. The measurement according to celestial time, which celestial time signifies one day to a cubit. And that's an interesting item. One day in Kolob is equal to 1,000 years according to the measurement of this earth, which is called by the Egyptians Ja'oeh. Figure number 2 stands next to Kolob. That is in this great stellar system over which Kolob presides as the governing body. Stands next to Kolob. It's called by the Egyptians Oliblish. which is the next grand governing creation near to the celestial, or the place where God resides, holding the key of power also pertaining to other planets, as revealed from God to Abraham as he offered sacrifice upon an altar which he had built unto the Lord. And then let's come down to figure number 5. It's called in the Egyptians Enish Ganandash. This is one of the governing planets also, and is said by the Egyptians to be the sun, and to borrow its light. Note that. The sun isn't just a hot coal setting out there. To borrow its light from Kolob to the medium of Cave Anrash, which is the grand key, or in other words, the governing power, which governs 15 other fixed planets or stars, also Phloresis, or the moon, the earth and the sun in their annual revolutions. This planet receives its power through the medium of Kyphlosis and the Anhakoko being, the stars represented by numbers 22 and number 3, receiving light from the revolutions of Kolob. Now, if you can get the vision of things there, we're dealing with a whole huge orbit of suns and stars and planets and moons and so forth, and the center of them is Kolob. Now, in Abraham chapter 3, Abraham apparently extended his understanding of these things by the use of the Urim and Thummim. Now, the Urim and Thummim operates on a visual principle. And he says here in chapter 3, verse 1, I, Abraham, had the Urim and Thummim, which the Lord my God gave unto me in Ur of the Chaldees. And I saw the stars, and they were great, that they were, that one of them was nearest unto the throne of God. And again now, not nearest necessarily in the sense of distance, nearest in government, nearest in orderly operation. And he says, there were many great ones which were near to it. And the Lord said unto me, these are the governing ones, and the name of the great one is Kolob, because it is near unto me, for I am the Lord thy God. I have set this one to govern all those which belong to the same order as that upon which thou standest. Now, what has he said there? The Kolob is the great governing orb of a whole galaxy, that same order of things upon which of which this earth is a part, and on which Abraham then was standing. You see that? He says, and the Lord said to me by the Urim and Thummim, that Kolob was after the manner of the Lord, according to its times and its seasons and in the revolutions thereof, that one revolution was a day unto the Lord, after this manner, after his manner of reckoning, being 1,000 years according to the time appointed to that whereon thou standest. So as our earth then revolves 365,000 times, the mighty planet Kolob, so huge and so great and so immense that it makes one revolution. And that mighty planet, or mighty star actually, Kolob, then is the great governing orb of the order of things to which we belong. Now, having explained these things and to Abraham, then the Lord showed Abraham his creations, and the person we're dealing here now with in giving the revelation was Jehovah. Jehovah showed Abraham his creations. And note, for example, how it's explained here in the book, chapter 3 of Abraham, verse 11. Thus I, Abraham, talked with the Lord, face to face, as one man talketh with another. And this is Jehovah with whom he's speaking. And he told me of the works of his hands had made. I was not talking about all the other stuff. He's talking about his own personal creations. And he said unto me, my son, my son. And his hands were stretched out. Behold, I will show you all these. And he put his hand upon mine eyes, and I saw those things which his hands had made, which were many, and they multiplied before mine eyes, and I could not see the end thereof. Now, he was seeing a little more than our stellar system, see. And then he makes these clarifications. Let me just excerpt a couple of comments, one from the latter part of verse 16. Kolob is the greatest of all the Kokobim, or stars, that is, that thou hast seen, because it is nearest unto me. And then again, for example, verse 21, I dwell in the midst of them all. I now therefore have come down unto thee to deliver unto thee the works which my hands have made. Oh, now that's the setting. That's the setting. The orderly cosmos, as time, space, stars, planets pertain to man on this earth, these then are centered in Kolob. Now, another one just by way of introduction, and then we want to get to the Doctrine and Covenants contributions, which are very, very significant to this whole cosmic picture. Let me turn now with you to the book of Moses, chapter 1. Now, here Moses, in a great vision, and the date and the time of this vision was after the burning bush and before he went into Egypt to redeem the Israelites at that period of time. So he had the knowledge of all of this when he went into Egypt. Now in Moses chapter 1, for example, the Lord's talking to him about this earth and his many creations. And then in verse 32, he says this, and by the word of my power have I created them, which is mine only begotten Son. Now note, the word of God's power is his only begotten Son. They're equated. They're the same. They're just different names for the same thing. Which is mine only begotten Son, who is full of grace and truth, and worlds without number have I created. And I also created them for mine own purpose, and by the Son I created them, which is mine only begotten. And then he goes on and says, and the first man of all men have I called Adam, which is many. Now he's not talking about our earth. He's talking about worlds without number, created by and through the only begotten, and about the populating of those earths. And the first man of all men on each orb he calls Adam, which means that Adam is a title, a name. It's a title of transition from the paradisiacal state of initial creation to the fall, and has centered in it then the idea of the beginning of life and the origins of things. See, the first man of all men have I called Adam, which is many. But only an account, he says, of this earth and the inhabitants thereof give I unto you. For behold, there are many worlds that have passed away. Now he's talking, this is Christ speaking in the office and power of the Father to Moses. And as of that time, which to us would be somewhere around 1300 and something B.C. For this earth, as of that time, he says, now there are many worlds that have passed away by the word of my power, and there are many that now stand. And innumerable are they unto man, but all things are numbered unto me, for they are mine, and I know them. And it came to pass that Moses spake unto the Lord, saying, be merciful unto thy servant, O God, and tell me concerning this earth, and the inhabitants thereof, and also the heavens, and then thy servant will be content. So you focus it and bring it down out of this earth. Then the Lord says unto Moses, the heavens, they are many, and they cannot be numbered unto man, but they are numbered unto me, for they are mine. And as one earth shall pass away, and the heavens thereof, that is the atmospheric heavens thereof, even so shall another come. And there is no end to my works, neither to my words. And then note the next verse begins with the word for, which was a transitional conjunction. For behold, this is my work and my glory, to bring to pass the immortality and eternal life of man. Now he's not talking in that statement about merely about life on this earth. He's talking rather instead on the great cosmic plane. He's talking about worlds without number. The first man of all men have I called Adam. And that as one world passes away, so He creates another. And then continuing that thought on that same plane, for behold, this is my work and my glory, to bring to pass the immortality and the eternal life of man. Now with this setting, let me turn to section 76 of the Doctrine and Covenants. And let's begin with verse 12 here, where the prophet is introducing the revelation. Well, we go back to verse 11. We, Joseph Smith and Sidney Rigdon, being in the Spirit on the 16th day of February in the year of our Lord 1832, by the power of the Spirit our eyes were opened and our understandings were enlightened so as to see and understand the things of God, even those things which were from the beginning, before the world was, which were ordained of the Father through His only begotten Son, who was in the bosom of the Father, even from the beginning. Now Christ then is in the bosom of the Father, and He's the great creative agent of the Father, even from the beginning. So we call Him Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the author and the finisher of our faith. But that statement applies beyond us. It applies then to the cosmic picture, see? Now he goes on and says, of whom we bear record, and the record which we bear is the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ, who is the Son whom we saw and with whom we conversed in the heavenly vision. For while we were doing the work of translation, and he calls the revision of the Bible translation, because it was done through the same principle that he translated the Book of Mormon, a revelatory principle, see? Now he didn't have the old original manuscripts of the Bible and then translate that way. He had the oldest original manuscript of all, namely the Holy Ghost, because holy prophets spake as they were moved upon by the Holy Ghost, and that's the way we got Scripture. And he said he was going back to what they wrote. He went back to the power of the Holy Ghost, and he calls it translation. And it's consistent in his context. All right, he says, for while we were doing the work of translation which the Lord had appointed unto us, we came to the 29th verse of the 5th chapter of John, which was given unto us as follows, speaking of the resurrection of the dead, concerning those who shall hear the voice of the Son of Man and shall come forth. They who have done good to the resurrection of the just. Now the version in John says, they that have done good unto the resurrection of life. And it's not that that's a false idea, but the prophet was given another view of the thing, other than that which was found in John. They have done good unto the resurrection of the just, and they have done evil unto the resurrection of the unjust. And the biblical statement is, they have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. Now we may get back to that a little later today. He says, now this caused us to marvel, for it was given unto us of the Spirit. And while we meditated upon these things, the Lord touched the eyes of our understanding, and they were opened, and the glory of the Lord shone round about. And we beheld the glory of the Son on the right hand of the Father, and received of His fullness. And we saw the holy angels, and them that are sanctified before His throne, worshiping God forever, and the Lamb who worshiped Him forever and ever. And then note this beautiful testimony, and this is where we get some interesting additions to this great cosmic picture. He says, and now after the many testimonies which have been born or given of Him, this is the testimony last of all that we give, that He lives, for we saw Him even on the right hand of God, and we heard the voice bearing record from heaven that He is the only begotten of the Father. Now note verse 24 and 5. Well, verse 24, that by Him, that is, by Christ, and through Him, through Christ, and of Him, of Christ, the worlds are and were created, and the inhabitants thereof, the inhabitants of all these worlds, are begotten are begotten sons and daughters unto God. Now what does it mean to be begotten through Christ, to be made a son or a daughter, as the case may be, of God? It's not talking there of spirit birth, of us being children of our Father in heaven in pre-earth life. It's not talking of physical life. It's talking of that divine program by which we can, through Christ's atonement, be born again and become sons and daughters of Christ in those divine powers and attributes and truths that lead to eternal life. Now let me turn to the prophet's poetic vision of this one. See how he expresses it. Now after all of the proofs made of him by witnesses truly by whom he was known, this is mine, last of all, that he lives. Yea, he lives and sits at the right hand of God on his throne. And I heard a great voice bearing record from heaven. He's the Savior and only begotten of God. By him and of him and through him the worlds were all made, even all the career in the heavens so broad. Now note this, whose inhabitants too, from the first to the last, are saved by the very same Savior as ours, and of course are begotten God's daughters and sons by the very same truths and the very same powers. Now what have we learned from this great statement? That Christ is not only the great Creator, but that he also redeems those worlds which he creates, that many of them are populated with the spirit sons and daughters of our Father in heaven. They were created by and through Christ in the office and with the title of the only begotten Son of God. And then he came here to this earth to redeem that which he had created. And look, for example, let me give you the testimony of President Joseph Fielding Smith on one point. In his interesting little book on the signs of the times, he's treating the Lord's statement here to the patriarch Enoch as the Lord looks upon the inhabitants of the earth in that day. And he says of the people who were then living, the fire of my indignation is kindled against them, and my hot displeasure will I send in the floods upon them, for my fierce anger is kindled against them. Behold, I am God. Man of holiness is my name. Man of counsel is my name. Man an endless and eternal is my name. Wherefore, I can stretch forth mine hands and hold all the creations which I have made, and mine eye can pierce them also. And among all the workmanship of mine hands, there has not been so great wickedness as among my brethren. And then President Smith makes this comment. This is a terrible arraignment against the inhabitants of this earth. Perhaps this is the reason Jesus Christ was sent here instead of to some other world. For in some other world they would not have crucified him, and his presence was needed here because of the extreme wickedness in the inhabitants of this earth. Now, how does President Joseph Fielding Smith understand it? He's merely giving you his opinion here in relation to the matter, but he certainly has the view that Christ came here to make a redemption that applies then to other worlds. Now, the Savior came to this earth to redeem all that the Father had made, created, and made by him. Let me go back to section 76, this marvelous revelation that's got more in it sometimes than we really think. Section 76, beginning with verse 40, the prophet is recording a little bit here on the mission of the Savior again. And he says, this is the gospel. And note how broad and comprehensive now the gospel is as he defines it here. This is the gospel, the glad tidings which the voice out of the heavens bore record unto us. that he came into the world, even Jesus, to be crucified for the world, and to bear the sins of the world, and to sanctify the world, and to cleanse it from all unrighteousness, that through him all might be saved. Note this, whom the Father had put into his power and made by him. Now what's the gospel? He came here to do what? He came here that through him all might be saved, whom the Father had put into his power and made by him. He came here to save everything that he, Christ, created under the direction and power and authority of the Father. He says, who glorifies the Father and saves all the works of his hands, except those sons of perdition who deny the Son after the Father has revealed them. Now let me go back to the prophet's inspired poetic version of that one. The mystery of godliness truly is great, the past and the present and what is to be. And this is the gospel, glad tidings to all, which the voice from the heavens bore record to me. That he came to the world in the middle of time to lay down his life for his friends and his foes, and bears away sin as a mission of love, and sanctifies earth for the blessed repose. 'Tis decreed that he'll save all the works of his hands and sanctify them by his own precious blood, and purify earth for the Sabbath of rest by the agent of fire, as it was by the flood. The Savior will save all the Father did give, even all that he gave in the regions abroad, save the sons of perdition. They're lost, ever lost, and can never return to the presence of God. Now can you begin to get the picture of Christ as a great Redeemer, a great Creator of worlds without number, and as the Redeemer of all that the Father put into his hands and made by him? And then can you begin to see the significance of this earth, which is the redemptive earth, and how this redemptive earth figures in the total cosmic picture of Christ's creations, and who Christ was when he walked in mortality, and who we are, and what relationship we have and this earth has to this great cosmic scene. Now those are the things that we need seriously to contemplate. In section 88 of the Doctrine and Covenants, the Lord gives us some beautiful explanations concerning the government of all things in this great cosmic scene. And that government then, he indicates, is carried out by a divine agent that we call the light of Christ. And the light of Christ then is merely the manifestation of his glory. Now, in order to see this with some kind of comprehension, we need to view God in a proper way. Sometimes we merely view him as a person, and he is, and this is a vital part of his organized being. So that the prophet could say, as he does in section 130, the Father has a body of flesh and bones as tangible as man's, and the Son also, see. But sometimes we merely leave it at that. Now, the Doctrine and Covenants especially teaches that God has not only a corporeal or a physical nature, but he also has a divine nature. And his divine nature is as much a part of his organized being as your physical body is a part of your being. His divine nature is glory, and the glory of God is intelligence. And that glory, those powers of truth and light and intelligence are so concentrated in him that the very radiance of them would eclipse the light of the sun at noonday. The prophet Joseph Smith taught that all light and heat are the glory of God, which is his power. Note, for example, how Joseph Smith expresses it here. This is the teachings, page 367. Speaking now of God, he says in this interesting statement, God Almighty Himself dwells in eternal fire. We kind of get the idea that the other place. He's talking about the other place here. But let me just suggest you take the old sectarian concept of hell and turn it upside down, and you get the beginnings of the Mormon concept of heaven. Now, you just kind of get that vision of things, okay? And because we're not dealing with a mere being of corporeal organization and stature. We're dealing with a glorified being. God Almighty Himself dwells in eternal fire. Flesh and blood cannot go there. He didn't say flesh and bones. Flesh and blood cannot go there, for all corruption is devoured by the fire. Then he quotes the Apostle Paul, who's quoting from the book of Deuteronomy, our God is a consuming fire. When our flesh is quickened by the Spirit, there will be no blood in this tabernacle. Some dwell in higher glory than others. There's celestial glory, celestial fire, terrestrial fire, telestial fire. We'll talk about the degrees of glory, but they're not just places. They're places of endowment. They're places of glorification. And he goes on to say, immortality dwells in everlasting burnings. All men who are mortal dwell in everlasting burnings. You've heard the statement in Levit, who shall ascend to the hill of the Lord? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart and so forth. Have you ever read Isaiah's version of that one? Let me read it to you. It's in Isaiah chapter 33. And it starts out with this inquiry. Verse 14, who among us shall dwell with the devouring fire? Immediately, who comes to your mind? Well, the devil and all his imps, and those who become sons of perdition. Now note Isaiah's answer. Who among us shall dwell with the devouring fire? Who among us shall dwell with everlasting burnings? He that walketh righteously and speaketh uprightly, he that despiseth the gain of oppressions, that shaketh his hands from holding of bribes, the stop of his ears from hearing of blood, and shut of his eyes from seeing evil. In other words, he doesn't view many movies or much television. He shall dwell on high. Okay? He shall dwell on high. Now, in section 88 of the Doctrine and Covenants, then, the Lord is revealing a few things concerning this glorified being and the relationship of His glory as made manifest in the light of Christ to govern and direct and sustain the orderly cosmos. And the revelation begins with the Lord speaking to a few brethren and giving them the promise of eternal life. We call it calling election sure. Now again, this is 1832, that early. And this carries with it, this promise, this guarantee, carries with it certain responsibilities and certain restrictions, but it also carries with it the guarantee that a person will enjoy eternal life in the celestial kingdom. Not exaltation in this instance, there are different degrees of calling election. In this instance, merely eternal life. And he says this in verse 3, wherefore I now send upon you another comforter, even upon you, my friends, that it may abide in your hearts, even the Holy Spirit of promise. Which other comforter is the same that I promised to my disciples, as is recorded in the testimony of John? Perhaps I ought to just throw in an interpolated clarification here. There are two second comforters. There's one first comforter, and there are two second comforters. The first comforter is the Holy Ghost, and its role then is to comfort, enlighten, and to sanctify and to bless, to be a source of revelation and of gifts and of spiritual life to the saints. Now, in the area of the second comforter is what we call the second comforter of promise. Hiram Smith, for example, gave a blessing to the late Kimball, who is the choice and lovely wife of Heber C. Kimball. And he says, Sister the late Kimball, I lay my hands upon your head and seal you unto eternal life. This, he says, is called the second comforter, not his presence, but his promise. Now, the second comforter, if I can put it that way, is the privilege that flows from the first. One who is sealed to eternal life then has the privilege of personal communion with the Lord, with those in His presence, the spirits of just men made perfect, angels, the General Assembly, Church of the Firstborn, etc. Now, what he's talking about here is the first of the second comforters, the promise of eternal life. Note, let me read it over with you. Wherefore I now send upon you another comforter, even upon you, my friends, so that it may abide in your hearts. Now, he's not talking about Christ here. This comforter is going to abide where? In your hearts. He says, even the Holy Spirit of promise. Which other comforter is the same that I promised my disciples, as is recorded in the testimony of John? See, this is the initial thing, the guarantee of eternal life. And he calls it then the same that he gave to his disciples in the, as recorded in the testimony of John. Read John chapter 14, and if you want, read the prophet Joseph's clarifications on that in the teachings, page about 149 through 51 of the teachings. Now, in this revelation, verse 4, he tells us what this comforter is. He says, this comforter is the promise which I give unto you of eternal life, even the glory of the celestial kingdom. Now, that's what this comforter, or this aspect of the second comforter, is. And then from that point of things, speaking to these men who had received that promise, then he talks about the glory of the celestial kingdom, this brilliance of light and fire and of intelligence that constitutes his divine nature and in which he is enveloped, and which celestial life lives in, and is blessed by in his quickening and divine powers. He says, which glory is that of the Church of the Firstborn, even of God, the holiness of all, through Jesus Christ, his Son. See, that's the glory that the Lord holds in store for those who sanctify their lives and develop within the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, until they make their calling election sure and come then to the inner church, the Church of the Firstborn. And these then in eternity enjoy this glory. Now he says, now speaking of Christ, who is the center of this program, in this great cosmic picture, he that ascended up on high, as also he descended below all things. Now he descended below all things in Gethsemane, in the great agony of the withdrawal of the divine nature that he had to make an infinite atonement and to pay the debt of sin for repentant sinners. And then he descended below all things in a physical and temporal way and on the cross in giving his life, his sinless life, for mankind to pay the debt of Adam and bring about the resurrection and return men back into God's presence to be judged. For mankind to pay the debt of Adam and bring about the resurrection and return men back into God's presence to be judged. All right, he that ascended upon high, as also he descended below all things, in that he comprehended all things. He went down to the bottom of the cesspool so that he could comprehend the depths as well as the heights. And this is what it means to have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm sorry, this gets a little bit touchy to me. This is what it means to believe in Him. There isn't a person who's gone so far down in the depths of darkness and of sin and transgression but what Christ hasn't been below him. Voluntarily, as an innocent sacrifice, he's been below him. And he knows the way out. He knows the way back. He knows how to lead the individual, however darkened his mind may be, and however much he may be in despair, and how far down the tube he may be. He knows enough how to bring that person back. He has descended below all things, in that he comprehends all things. Now he goes on to say, that he might be in and through all things the light of truth. Now the great purpose of his atonement wasn't just to forgive sin. The great purpose of his atonement But to bring about that divine plan by which His glory could be infused in all those who would believe in Him. And so He descended below all things, that He might comprehend all things, and that He might be in all and through all things the light of truth, that He might infuse His glory, His truth, His power, to give us that kind of life that celestial beings have. See, that's the great purpose. And then speaking of that divine truth and light of truth, Now truth carries with it an illuminatory principle. Truth is light. In a sense they're used in relation to each other and to the same. But technically speaking, light is the radiance of truth. And so he says that he might be in and through all things the light of truth, which truth shineth. And that's the radiance. This is the light of Christ. Now that radiance of light that comes from the truth, and that truth that he's talking about is the light and truth of his glory. The glory of God is intelligence, or in other words, light and truth, and truth shines, and the radiance of that truth then is the light of Christ. And the light of Christ, centering in Christ as a being, as a resurrected being then, emanates from his presence and fills the immensity of space. And it's the great creative agent, and it's the great redemptive agent, and the great sustaining agent in the whole orderly cosmos, see. And so he says then, which truth shineth, this is the light of Christ, as also he is in the Son, and the light of the Son, and the power thereof by which it was made. Now, sunlight is part of the light of Christ. Men like Parley P. Pratt and Charles W. Penrose and others took this concept of the light of Christ and explained on it a few in various statements that they make. And they indicate that this light emanates from Christ, and it's expanded out in a great spectrum, if I can put it that way. And down here on the less refined area of this light is sunlight. And then you move on up the ways to the more intelligent expressions and manifestations of this light, and you get to the light of instinct, that light then that quickens animal and marine life and gives them their law, that light then that tells the salmon where to go and the migratory birds what to do, see? And then on up the way, then it's the light of reason within man by which we live and move and have a being. As the Apostle John says, in Him, Christ, we live and move and have a being. And it's the power then by which we discern, and by which we reason, and by which we analyze, by which we have intellectual powers. As Orson Pratt put it, the light of Christ enters into and interacts with the light of our organized spirit and gives us the capability of thought and analysis and judgment, see. Now, in order to move from that point on up to the higher degrees of life, you have to have faith in Christ. You've got to center your life in Him, and you've got to repent of your sins. Because you've got to start clearing away the clutter that's between, because this light is so pure and so holy that it just doesn't manifest itself in a lot of corruption. And so faith in Christ is important, and repentance is important. And then in addition to that, then you have to have the ordinances of the gospel, baptism for the remission of sins, and the official laying out of hands for the gift of the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost is a person then takes Christ's light. He doesn't have it himself. Christ is the light and the life of the world, and the Holy Ghost is a subordinate agent to Him. As He says in John chapter 6 concerning Jesus, He shall receive of mine and shall shew it unto you, see? And so the Holy Ghost then begins to manifest it in its gospel expressions, with its gifts and its fruits, its revelations and its powers. And it can get on up into the baptism of fire, where cloven tongues of fire begin to rest upon it. And then finally it can get on up to where you're glorified with the cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night. And then in the resurrection, if we're faithful, we can get the fullness of it and dwell in everlasting burning, see? Now that's the basic concept of the gospel and of life, see? And in that sense then, he talks about this now in relation to the Son. And he says, "It's also He, Christ, is in the Son. And He's the light of the Son, and the power of by which it was made." And he says, "And also He is in the moon, and is the light of the moon, and the power of by which it was made. And also the light of the stars, and the power of by which they were made. And the earth also and the power thereof, even the earth upon which you stand, and the light which shineth, this three-dimensional stuff by which we see and discern and perceive, the light which shineth, which giveth you light, is through him who enlighteneth your eyes, which is the same light, this light that we see through, it's the same light that quickens your understanding. It's this light by which we live and move and have a being, see? And it centers in Christ. He is the light and the life of the world. Everything centers in him. All life centers in him. The universe centers in him. All orderly things, all organized life centers in him. He is the light and the life of the world, and we're that dependent upon him. Now he goes on, he says, speaking now of this light, he says, which light proceedeth forth from the presence of God to fill the immensity of space. A note there, to fill the immensity of space, the light which is in all things, which giveth life to all things, which is the law by which all things are governed, even the power of God, who sitteth upon his throne, who is in the bosom of eternity, who is in the midst of all things. And then he makes certain explanations here concerning the application of this to us in relation to our lives here. I won't take time to get in them today. We may talk about them here this afternoon. But he makes it clear that in this program, our earth, for example, abides a celestial kingdom, a law, and it's going to be redeemed to a celestial glory. It's going to be a brilliant orb of glory and power above the light of the sun. The prophet Joseph Smith, coming back to the central role of this earth as the redemptive earth, and it is not just another one, it's the redemptive earth, and it was created not in this solar system. The book of Abraham, chapter 5, verse 3, tells you it was created next to Kolob, and in the fall it was placed in this solar system. And when the millennial period is over and the earth is glorified, it will go back to its original place, and the prophet Joseph Smith taught that it will stand next to Kolob in the great governing program of this whole stellar system, which you may call the Milky Way galaxy, this whole stellar system of which Kolob is the center, see. And our earth, then, is the redemptive earth, and we'll have the privilege of living here and being part of this program and being a part of the great dispensation of the fullness of times that's going to wrap this program up and bring us to be saviors on Mount Zion and to share then in the glory of all these things as they center in Christ. Now, let me turn, for example, to verse 36 on through about verse 35 and pick up some further explanations on these things. He says, all kingdoms have a law given, and there are many kingdoms, for there is no space in the which there is no kingdom. And there is no kingdom in which there is no space, even a greater or lesser kingdom. And unto every kingdom is given a law, and to every law there are certain bounds and also conditions. All beings, now note, all beings referring to the fact that there are many kingdoms with no space in which there is no kingdom, so it's talking about microscopic as well as macroscopic. Now, all beings, and that includes then the primal life then, before spirit birth, all beings then who have, who abide not, those conditions are not justified. And then it tells us of the great binding or cementing principle by which the whole orderly cosmos is bound together. And it says, for intelligence cleaveth unto intelligence. There's a natural affinity between intelligence and intelligence, and they cleave then one to another. He says, wisdom receiveth wisdom, truth embraces truth, virtue loveth virtue, light cleaveth unto light, mercy hath compassion on mercy and claimeth her own, justice continueth its course and continueth and claimeth its own, judgment goeth before the face of him who sitteth upon the throne and governeth and executeth all things. And then speaking of God in the role not just as a physical being, but the role of the divine being with glory that indwells within all of this, so that he is in and through all things, and the elements are his tabernacle. Not just that he's got a tabernacle of elements, but the elements, as section 93 says, are his tabernacle. And he's in and through all things. He says on that principle now of his omniscience and his omnipresence, and His power. He says, He comprehendeth all things, and all things are before Him, and all things are round about Him. And He is above all things, and in all things. See? Not just above, He is in through His glory. He dwells within all things, and is through all things, and is round about all things. And all things are by Him, and of Him, even God, forever and ever. I call this our prepositional scripture. I was once told by an English teacher that preposition is anything the worm can do to an apple. And you think of that for a minute. It can be in and through and over and above and under and all of that. And this is our prepositional scripture concerning God's relationship with the orderly cosmos. He is above all things. He's in all things. He's through all things. He's round about all things. See? And in that sense, then, He's not only omnipotent, but He's omniscient and omnipresent. All right. Going on, then, He says, for instance, "And again, verily I say unto you, He hath given a law unto all things by which they move in their times and their seasons. And their courses are fixed, even the courses of the heavens and the earth, which comprehend the earth and all the planets. And they give light to each other in their times and in their seasons and their minutes and in their hours and in their days and in their weeks and in their months and in their years. And all these are one year with God, but not with man. The earth rolls upon her wings, and the sun giveth his light by day, and the moon giveth her light by night, and the stars also give their light as they roll upon their wings in their glory, in the midst of the power of God." See? In the midst of the power of God. You know, W. Phelps was an interesting personality. He had an inquisitive mind, he had a theological bent, and he had a close personal relationship with the prophet Joseph Smith. They came out here to Utah. He used to publish an almanac, and something like Ben Franklin's almanac. He put interesting little sayings in them, but a lot of the times he put his own poetry in it. Now, here's one of his poems published from his almanac. "Up in the heavens above, where the life-giving power is spread undivided, there is a fountain of love, where the priesthood in virtue as head hath presided over planets and stars and their beings forever. High in those mansions so bright, where the footsteps of men never tread in probation, there is a fountain of light, where true wisdom and knowledge is spread in rotation to millions of worlds and their peoples forever. Right in the center of this is a throne where our Father sits crowned with his neighbors." You pick that one up. "Here is the spirit of bliss, which the wisdom of man never found by his labors, even light, which is life to creations forever." And that's a choice one. That's really a choice one. Now, let's move, for example, to another part of section 88. The Lord here gives us a parable concerning His creations. And I'd like to preface this parable by reading a statement from Marion G. Romney. Came out in the old improvement era for November of 1968. He's quoting here scriptural passages on the creations of Christ, worlds without number have I created, and all of these things. And then he says, having quoted the statement, "For this is my work and my glory, to bring to pass the immortality and eternal life of man on not just this but other worlds." Then he says, "From this and other scriptures, we learn that representing the Father and serving His purpose to bring to pass the immortality and eternal life of man, Jesus Christ, in the sense of being its Creator and Redeemer, is the Lord of the whole universe, except for His earthly ministry accomplished on this planet, His service and relationship to other worlds and their inhabitants are the same as His service and relationship to this earth and its inhabitants." Now, do you pick the idea up? Except for the atonement that He made here, His service and His relationship to other planets is the same, or the same, as his service and his relationship to this planet. Now, let me turn to section 88, starting with verse 46. Having revealed to the prophet this great cosmic picture, then of worlds and kingdoms and so forth, then the Lord says this in verse 46, unto what shall I liken these kingdoms, that ye may understand? Behold all these kingdoms, and any man who hath seen any, or the least of them, hath seen God moving in his majesty and power. You've seen a blade of grass. God dwells in it, and that life within it is a revelation of him. And you've seen God. It's the immanence of divinity within all things. Eh? I say unto you, he hath seen him. Nevertheless, he who came into his own was not comprehended. The light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehendeth it not. Nevertheless, the day shall come when you shall comprehend even God being quickened in him by him. When he turns the rheostat up so that we are in the same divine principle, then you begin to comprehend him. He says, behold, I will liken these kingdoms, these many worlds, to a man having a field. And he sent forth his servants into the field to dig in the field. And he said unto the first, go ye and labor in the field, and in the first hour I will come unto you, and ye shall behold the joy of my countenance. Now this field is a world, and he's going to go visit that, see. That's what he's saying. And he said unto the second, go ye also into the field, and in the second hour I will visit you with the joy of my countenance. And so he's going to withdraw from one world and go to another one. Okay? And he said then also to the third, saying, I will visit you, and so unto the fourth, and so on to the twelfth. And the Lord of the vineyard went unto the first in the first hour. And that was his millennium, the millennium of this first world. And tarried with him all that hour, and he was made glad by the light of his countenance. And then he withdrew from the first, that he might visit the second also, and the third, and the fourth, and so on unto the twelfth. And thus they all received the light of the countenance of their Lord, every man in his hour, and in his time, and in his season, beginning at the first, and so on to the last, Christ's creations. And there is a first, and there is a last in Christ's creations. Beginning of the first, and so on to the last. And then another action from the last to the first. Now you ponder on that one. And a third action from the first to the last. Every man, he says, in his order, every world that is, in his order, until his hour was finished, even according as his Lord had commanded him, that his Lord might be glorified in him. See, these are fallen worlds. In need of redemption, in need of glorification and sanctification, see? That he might be glorified him, and he and his Lord that they might be glorified. Therefore, unto this parable, the Lord says, I will liken these kingdoms and the inhabitants thereof. Every kingdom in its hour, in its time, and in its season, according to the decrees which God hath set. Now note, he's talking about Christ's ministry to the worlds of his creation. And he begins with the first and he goes to the last. And then there's some kind of action where he goes from the last on back to the first. And then there's some action where he goes from the first to the last. And all of this is part of the great process by which this whole retinue of worlds is glorified, redeemed, finally presented to the Father. Now, let me just note this. I think there's a similarity between what goes on this earth and what goes on in eternity. In this earth, there have been several dispensations in Christ's ministry, each major prophet of each dispensation, right on down to the last. And this dispensation that we are living in relation to this earth is a redemptive dispensation. It's the one into which all others are gathered, and by which they are all brought to a fullness, like we talked about yesterday, okay? And then, having come to this dispensation, done the work, and got the fullness in this dispensation, then we extend the glory from the last back to the first, okay? And then, in order to complete the process, you seal all past dispensations from the first to the last, to make the dispensation of the fullness of times. You get the idea? Now, similarly, may I suggest, and I'm merely suggesting it, may I suggest that there is an eternal dispensation of the fullness of times in the great cosmic picture, and that Christ ministers from the first to the last, and the last is that world upon which he makes his atonement, and on which he carries out the essentials by which the whole thing will be redeemed. And when he has brought things to a fullness there, then he extends the glory from the last back to the first. And then he seals them from the first to the last to make an eternal dispensation of the fullness of times which can be presented to the Father. Now let me give you a little evidence on this, can I? From the scriptures and from other source statements by the prophet Joseph Smith. First of all, when you talk about this earth scripturally and in light of concepts by the prophet Joseph Smith, you don't talk merely about this earth alone. When the prophet, for example, in this poetic version, he talks about the great council in Kolob, from the grand council in Kolob to time on the earth. Now, when it comes to the creation, as Joseph Smith explained it to us, and let me turn here to page 348 and 9, he says this, "The head God called together the gods and sat in grand council to bring forth the world. The grand counselor sat at the head in yonder heavens and contemplated the creation of the worlds, plural, which were created at the time." So we go back then to pre-earth life and talk about that picture. It's a bigger thing than just our earth, okay? Now, let me give you another statement by the prophet Joseph. You add all these things up, and I'm just giving to you to kind of bug you and let you ponder a few things, if you'll pardon me that. Here's another statement by the prophet. He says, "It was the design of Jehovah from the commencement of the world, and is his purpose now, to regulate the affairs of the world in his own time, to stand as a head of the universe and take the reins of government in his own hands." Now, his second coming to this earth is not just to rule and reign on this earth. It's to take the reins of the universe. Now, there's another statement. Now, let me read you another one from the prophet Joseph. Page 250. This one now is from page 291. He's talking about the book of Revelation and John the Apostle's revelation there on Isle of Patmos. And he says, "I suppose John saw beings there of a thousand forms that had been saved from 10,000 times 10,000 earths like this. Strange beasts of which we have no conception. All might be seen in heaven. The grand secret was to show John what there was in heaven. John learned that God glorified himself by saving all that his hands had made, whether beasts, fowls, fishes, or men, and he will glorify himself in them." And then on that basis, he talks about those four beasts mentioned in the book of Revelation, which are individual animals, but made the types then of the redemption of the animal kingdom in the whole orderly cosmos. And he says, "The four beasts were four of the most noble animals that had filled the measure of their creation and had been saved from other worlds because they were perfect, they were like unto angels." Another report of the prophet's discourse says, "Those were beasts which had lived on another planet than ours." Now the question is, why, see, John sees in the book of Revelation the cleansing of Zion, and he sees the cleansing of this earth and the ushering in of the millennial reign. And the question is then, why would four beasts from other worlds have anything to do with things here? They're not actually officiating, they're observing. But the answer, I believe, is that this is the redemptive earth, and they are representative of the orderly cosmos and the animal kingdom and have a representation here, see. Now, let me read you one other statement. This one gets a little more closer to things, to the final objective I'd like to have you see, and that's Moses chapter 7. In Moses chapter 7, the Lord here is speaking of the coming forth of Scripture in our day and the building of the New Jerusalem in our day, and our challenge now to bring about these purposes. In verse 62, he says, and righteousness will I send down out of heaven, and truth will I send forth out of the earth, to bear testimony of mine only begotten, his resurrection of the dead, yea, and also the resurrection of all men. Now the prophet Joseph Smith makes a clarification, page 84 of the teachings, of what he means by righteousness and truth. And he says, men and angels are to be co-workers in bringing to pass this great work. Zion is to be prepared, even a new Jerusalem, for the elect that are to be gathered from the four quarters of the earth. He makes that comment to the question I ask, how righteousness and truth are going to sweep the earth with the flood. Now righteousness equates with angels, men and angels. And he goes on to say then, here back to Moses 7, verse 62, and righteousness and truth will I cause to sweep the earth as with a flood, to gather out mine elect from the four corners of the earth unto a place which I shall prepare, an holy city, that my people may gird up their loins and be looking forth for the time of my coming. And therefore there shall be my tabernacle, and it shall be called Zion, a new Jerusalem. And then the Lord said unto Enoch, then shalt thou and all thy city meet them there. See, when we've built the new Jerusalem and it's endowed with glory and power, then there's going to be a union. The Zion from above will descend, and they'll be united with the Zion from below, just like section 88 says, about verse 99 or 100. And he says, and the Lord said unto Enoch, then shalt thou and all thy city meet them there, and we will receive them into our bosom, and they shall see us, and we shall fall upon their necks, and they shall fall upon our necks, and we shall kiss each other. And now note his comment here, very significant comment in verse 64. And there shall be mine abode, and it shall be called, and it shall be Zion, which shall come forth out of all the creations which I have made. And for 1,000 years the earth will rest. Now this Zion that is finally established when the city of Enoch returns, and when the millennial period is ushered in, how broad and comprehensive in scope will it be? It will be Zion which shall come forth out of all my creations which I have made. Now this brings us into the question of how about Enoch and his role. Let me just turn to page 170 in the teachings where the prophet Joseph Smith deals with him. And he says this concerning this great and ancient patriarch. He says, now this Enoch God reserved unto himself that he should not die at the time, but appointed him a ministry unto terrestrial bodies, of whom there has been but little revealed. He is reserved also for the presence of a dispensation. And then he goes on and says, of translated beings, their place of habitation is that of the terrestrial order, and a place prepared for such characters he held and reserved to be ministering angels and to many planets. Now, Enoch ministers to terrestrial bodies. There are two kinds of terrestrial bodies. There are resurrected terrestrial bodies, but Enoch wouldn't have anything to do with them because there had been no resurrection at the time. There are translated terrestrial bodies. You are, as Joseph Smith says, there are places of inhabitations of terrestrial order. And they're translated terrestrial bodies. And apparently Enoch, representing this redemptive earth, then he's given a presidency over these terrestrial bodies. So that when Christ went from one world to the other, see, there's no resurrection, there's no salvation for the dead until Christ makes the atonement here. But there is receiving the gospel, and you can get forgiveness of sins, and you can get the powers of the Spirit by reason of Christ's covenant to make the redemption. And even you can come to a point where you can be translated and taken to terrestrial state. And so as these worlds then came into being and had their mortality, and Christ ministered to them, many of the righteous were translated. And then Enoch is given the keys of power over them. So that when he comes, he unites them with this redemptive earth, and it's Zion which shall come forth out of all my creations which the Lord says he had made. See? Now can you begin to get the picture there? You begin to get the picture then of Christ as the great Creator and the great Redeemer, and of what that means and how possibly we figure in. See, there are two times in this dispensation that are of most import. One is the formative time, the foundation time, the Joseph Smith period. And that period of time was when the Lord laid the foundation, and He said, "This generation shall receive My word through you." But the saints themselves did not comply fully with those revelations. We didn't build Zion. We didn't establish the law of consecration. The prophet organized the school of the prophets, and it lasted for about 3 months and was disorganized. And there are many, many things that we simply didn't have the faith and the spiritual character and knowledge to come up and do. But there is another time coming when the Lord will shift gears, and when we will bring things back into the redemption, and we will go back and reread the Doctrine and Covenants, and this time we will do it. And this time we will build Zion. And that generation of people who are foreordained to bring about these events and this consummation of the Zion program, this is the second period of time that I'm referred to. And that's the thing that we're being introduced into now, and there are many living on earth today, and many of our young people are involved in here. And as President Benson has said, the eye of the Lord has been on them for generations and centuries and years past. And it's the destiny then of this group of people to awake, to listen to a living prophet, to get out of the state of lethargy, see. Now that doesn't mean, and I want to just mention that and come back to it later, because we get the mentality that you have to just literally work your soul into hell in order to get to heaven. And that's because we got the mentality of salvation by works. Let me suggest to you, and we'll get to this more fully, that the thing that's important is that you give your life to Christ. That's the thing that's important. And that you subordinate your will to Him, and that you live outside your life in service to others, and that you then have the Spirit of the Lord to guide you. And there are times, and there are seasons for various kinds of work. And you just make sure that you know by the Spirit of the Lord that you're doing all that you should do. And then keep in mind that it's line upon line and precept upon precept. And if you're standing on the great celestial escalator and you hang on and you do the things that are required, eventually it'll elevate you to the celestial kingdom, see. And you live in peace. And don't get so frenzied that you got to keep all the balls in the air juggling at the same time. They're all important. But make sure that you give your life to Christ. Make sure that you can feel the power of His Spirit in your life. And then make sure that you live and walk and make every decision that you make with the sanction of the Holy Spirit or its direction, see. Now that's the idea, and we'll come back a little bit further. But again, finally, we're living in a very significant period of time. We are living on a very significant earth. Christ came to this earth to redeem all that the Father created and made by Him. And the great dispensation is the redemptive dispensation of this earth is the one in which we live. And the great part of that redemptive dispensation is the one that is just opening up and of which we and our children will be a part, see. And it's going to be that redemptive dispensation that will bring all things finally up to Christ, by which He then can consummate His purposes, not just for this earth, but for this whole cosmic picture over which He presides as the Son of God and the Creator. Now the Lord bless us to see and understand this. I want to bury my testimony that Christ lives, that I know it with a perfect knowledge, that He lives and that He's working and that He's being very close and intimate today with His people, those who will open their eyes to see and open their ears to hear. He's in our midst, literally, personally. I know this, in our midst. The Lord bless us to know that. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Or I dare answer all of these after that kind of one. Venture an explanation. Again, let me come back and say that it's one thing to be a gospel student, and it's another thing to keep your eye on the prophet. And what we say here is you can take it for its evidence and all of that, but I don't have any business setting the doctrine of the church. I'm just trying to bring out and teach some of the things that the prophet Joseph taught. I've loving Him like I love my own life. Now, I've tried to get as close to Him since I was a kid as I could be. And I've been through the sources hour upon hour, journal upon journal.
And I'm just trying to tell you a few things and unburden myself a little. The privilege here of talking with you. Would you please explain again the relationship of the first and the last in relation to the cosmos? And it's simply this. This earth was the first one ordained out of all God's creations. And it's the last that was created. And it's that simple. And in this earth, our dispensation was the first that was ordained. Joseph after Jesus was the first one ordained, foreordained. And he's the last to come as the major prophet of the dispensation. And, but being last, he will be first. He's done more, save any man, for the salvation of men on this world than any others. And he'll eventually merit the fruits of that which will be to stand next to Christ, not just in this earth, but in this eternity, this great cosmic picture. Now, that's something of where and who Joseph Smith is. Did the worlds created before this redemption one have to wait for Christ's resurrection here? And that's answer is yes. Now, they could go back in the spirit world to a state of glory, but there was no resurrection. You say, well, they had to wait a long time. My answer to that is, well, we had to wait a long time on the other end of things just to come. So wait is the byword of the day, okay? Since Christ lived on this world, is it reasonable to assume that the inhabitants of other worlds know more about our world than we know about their world? And that's very possibly true. I mean, they would have to know that the redemption, since he didn't make the atonement there, was going to come somewhere else. It's like the Nephites and the Jews. Now, the Nephites knew all about the Jews, but those damn Jews, and I don't say that sarcastically, but even the apostles, when Jesus says, other sheep have I who are not of this fold, even the apostles didn't know what he meant, and they didn't have any inquiry. No incentive to say, what do you mean? And Jesus then explained, now, since they didn't do that, I'll tell you. You know what the Book of Mormon picture is. So the Nephites knew more about the Jews than the Jews did the Nephites. Did the dead of other worlds have to wait for the death and resurrection of Jesus to be resurrected? And that is yes. When I had another 20 minutes, I'd like to develop maybe some of that, but we'll just find it. How do we relate that earth in its celestial state will be next to Korah, but the earth was inhabited by the most wicked of all creations? That's a good question. Brigham Young put it this way. He says, this earth has been reduced in degradation and in the fall below all other earths. But if you read section 88, the earth abides a celestial law. It still is faithful. It's alive. This earth is alive. There's a principle of life within it, and there is conscious life. If you read the book of Moses, I think it's about chapter 7, Enoch then hears the earth mourn. You say, when are you going to clean house with me? See? Now there is an order of life. We'll talk about this next hour. The order of life related to all material and all matter. And this earth then has been reduced below all others, and since it keeps the law, on the merit of keeping the law, it will be exalted above all others, and on that principle it will stand next to Korah. Christ, God, is in all things through the pervasive power of his glory. There is no light, glory, in the sons of perdition. They are in outer darkness. Could you elaborate on this? It goes on, does glory have a multiplying power in the sense that after man is glorified, he can generate then increase in power? That's two questions. First is that sons of perdition are resurrected, and they are brought back by the power of Christ's resurrection into God's presence. And in that, then, they are not only spirit bodies tabernacled again in the flesh, but they are made alive spiritually, sufficient to where they can abide in God's presence to be judged. And then after the judgment, see, this privilege is given to them, is given through the atonement. And then after the judgments, they die a second spiritual death. There is no atonement for the second spiritual death. And the second spiritual death is not cushioned. Our first spiritual death is cushioned The light of the sun is given to us because this first spiritual death is cushioned. The light of the sun is part of God's glory. And if there had been total spiritual death, we wouldn't have had the light of the sun. But there is no cushioning for the second spiritual death. And their kingdom then is a kingdom of darkness. Even the light of the sun isn't there. And that's a beautiful place to be. They can't see each other in your filth, in your stink. Okay, second question. Multiplying power in the sense that after man is glorified, he can generate an increase in power, thus add to God's who is in all things. Yes, God is progressing in glory as well as in worlds and as well as in children. And there's a continual concentration of glory. You may get to that later this afternoon. I think we mentioned it, didn't we, sometime yesterday? When Jesus comes to Mount Zion before he comes to the world, is that the beginning of the finishing of his work? It's merely getting the foundation laid to consummate it. Will Zion from above join us before the millennium? No, Zion comes down from above at the opening of the millennium. The sign of the Son of Man, the brilliant light in the heaven, Prophet Jonah apparently taught, is the return to the city of Enoch, see? And that's at Christ coming in his glory. What is the condescension of God? Well, that's a little off the subject. It has several manifestations. One is that he condescended to give his only begotten Son in the atonement. Another one is then he condescends to establish the Constitution. That's a condescension. He suffered it to be so. And there's several expressions of the idea of condescension.